Okay, so I start again to explain the title of my talk and to tell you that there is an important broken symmetry of Navier-Stokes, which is a time reversal, T dot minus T and U dot minus U. And this symmetry is broken explicitly by the viscosity, which induces dissipation. And from another point of view, so there is irreversibility in Navier-Stokes equation induced by dissipation. But now I want to stress another important empirical fact that dissipation itself does not depend on viscosity for a large enough Reynolds number. This is illustrated on this picture here. And an explanation from this can be given by doing a local energy budget for weak solutions of Navier-Stokes equation. This was done, for example, by Duchaux-Robert in 2000. And if you do that, you observe that in addition to the viscous contribution to dissipation, there is a new term, d of u, which is given by the limit when L tends to zero of the third order of the structure function smoothed out by the gradient of a regular function. So because of this, there can be two situations because of this limit. If you assume that the velocity field is, for example, Hölder continuous with the exponent h, so that it is bounded by a term L to the h in the limit L tend to zero, then from the expression of d of u, you observe that it is bounded as L tend to zero by L to the 3 h minus 1, so that you have only, you have two situations. If h is greater than one third, d of u is bounded by a term that goes to zero when L tends to zero. It does not contribute to the dissipation. So you have you can have singularities, because if h is less than one, you have some sort of failure of differentiability. But these singularities do not dissipate energy. Well, if h is less or equal to one third, then you can have dissipation by singularities. And so this is connected to the famous Onsager conjecture, which was proved very recently by Isset in 2018, that in three dimensions, a mechanism for complete dissipation of all kinetic energy, even without the aid of viscosity, is available. So this is very interesting because in some sense, Onsager conjecture links irreversibility and singularity. And so the aim of my talk is to study this link. And for this, I will do two ways. In the first part of my talk, I will use the traditional way to study dissipation, energy budget, etc., is to impose a forcing in the flow at a given viscosity, and then measure energy input needed to maintain the total energy statistically constant. When I mean statistically constant, is something like is shown on this figure, where you observe that variation of kinetic energy fluctuate around the mean value like this. And so in this framework, you study energy input, epsilon I, as a function of mean. But we can also do an alternative way in which we impose the forcing, we force the flow, but we impose that the energy remains constant, exactly constant for all time. And then we measure the viscosity needed to sustain constant energy. So in this framework, what I will be interested is the behavior of nu, of this nu, to obtain this as a function of E. And of course, the second thing, you cannot do it easily by experiment, so I will use numerical investigation to do that. As for the traditional way, you can use experimental investigation, and this is what I will start by in the first part of my talk. So let's start by this experimental investigation. I remind you the framework, we impose a forcing to a flow at a given viscosity. And we measure the energy input needed to maintain the kinetic energy statistically constant. And what we are interested in is to do the limit viscosity tend to zero to see and to understand better this anomalous behavior of the energy dissipation. So of course, the advantage of using experimental investigation, and that's why we use it, we have infinite resolution so that we can resolve any kind of singularities that appear. But the difficulty, of course, is to vary viscosity and to perform the measurement. So for this, what we have done, we have used the von Karman flow. So you see, von Karman flow is just a cylinder filled with some fluid. And the forcing we apply is done via two counter-rotating propellers that you see in the bottom picture here. And when they rotate in one direction or another direction, you have different type of flows, which are not totally equivalent. And so we can measure energy input by performing a torque measurement, and we can see what is going on when viscosity is varied. And to go to the limit nu tend to zero, we will use the properties of helium-4, which is that if you take helium-4 at a high enough pressure and you decrease the temperature below a temperature which is of the order of 2.1 Kelvin, then the fluid goes from a state where it is a normal fluid with normal viscosity into a state of superfluid where the viscosity tends to zero. So we have been doing that in the Schreck experiment while we have done a lot of measurements in normal fluid using, for example, water like in giant von Karman or other type of fluid. So here is the result on the left. So what you see is the non-dimensional energy input, which we denote Kp as a function of the Reynolds number. By varying fluids, we have 6 order of magnitude. And the close points are measurements using normal fluids. And the open point, which I have put it at finite Reynolds number, but they should be really at infinite Reynolds number, they are measurements in the same condition, but using superfluid, so with no viscosity. And so you see that this anomaly is fully confirmed. That for 3 different forcing conditions, the red, the blue, and the green, sorry, measurement with viscosity or without viscosity gives the same energy input. So you really have an anomaly and a spontaneous symmetry breaking. So to try to understand this, we have tried to go into a very small scale in the helium experiment. And we have performed the energy spectra measurement decreasing in same condition, but just decreasing the temperature by 2.2, where the fluid is normal, to 1.58, where it is superfluid. And on the top here, you see different measurements at different scale changing the temperature. And you see that when the vortex are unpolarized, so that the mean intervortex distance is very small with respect to the Kolmogorov scale, we don't see anything. But now if we polarize the quantum vortices by applying a global rotation, so that the intervortex distance start to be of the order of the Kolmogorov scale, then you see that decreasing the temperature, you go from a normal turbulent spectrum with a cutoff, a dissipative cutoff, to a situation where it seems that the cutoff is progressively removed. So something is going at small scale, at the small dissipative scale, when we go from fluid to superfluid, when turbulence is polarized, that is the mean intervortex distance is of the order of the Kolmogorov scale. In superfluid, we cannot perform any more measurement. It's very difficult, and we sort of stopped there. We didn't have more ideas, but in the normal experiment, we can do direct investigation of what is going on at the dissipative scale using local Lagrangian and Eulerian velocity measurement, like the ones that are shown on the top left here. And the idea is to sort of track the most irregular structure by looking at this quantity, which is over line, which is the local energy transfer at the scale L. Because what we know is that in the limit L tend to zero, if these things tend to zero, there are no irregularities. So the idea is to look at the location where this thing is very big to look at the areas of the flow where which are more irregular. And you see that this quantity is very well devised for our velocity measurement because it only depends on the velocity measurement which we have direct access to. So this is what we did, and this is some example of irregular region. So here on the left, we have put the magnitude of this scalar indicator, tracing the intensity of the local energy transfer. So all these measurements are done at the Kolmogorov scale. So you see that there are still non-zero local energy transfer. And you see from this plot on the left where I have superimposed the local velocity field that you have a swirling motion around the area of big irregularity. And this was confirmed later by some 3D measurement when we observed that the area of high irregularity, which are traced here by intersection of two black lines, are always at the vicinity of vortices or vorticity sheets. But what is nice also is that, in fact, Theo Drivas in 2019 proved a theorem that directly provides a link between singularities and irreversibility. And this theorem states that the total Eulerian dissipation, so the contribution of both the viscous dissipation and the possible irregularity, the function d of u, should be equal in suitable limit to this quantity dl, which is a purely Lagrangian quantity, which is built from making the difference between backward and forward pair dispersion. So this indicator was first invented by Jucha et al. But then Theodore Drivas in 2019 proved that there is exact equivalence between this quantity dl and d plus d. So in our field, we have everything. Since we have also the Lagrangian trajectory, we can compute also d of l. And so we can prove, check that indeed there is a link between singularity and irreversibility. And you see here on the left, you see traces of singularity by marking the location where the total dissipation is very high. And on the right, you see computation of the irreversibility indicator, which is just computed using a difference between backward and forward dispersion. And you see that the location where they both are high coincide. And we have made a detailed statistical analysis to prove this coincidence. And this is very nice because now we have a tool to be able to explore both from an Eulerian and Lagrangian point of view, the area of high high irreversibility and high and the most irregular region. And in this little picture, for example, you see we have tracked in red location of a high vorticity, in blue location in red location of a high Eulerian dissipation, and trajectory location of a high irreversibility. And you see that they both coincide, but they seem to appear, in fact, at the location where two vortices interact. And so we believe that this high irregular region and highly irreversible are the location of reconnection. And right now, we are performing more experiments to be able to prove this link. Okay, so that's about it about the experimental investigation. Yes, are there questions on this part of the talk or?
Yes.
So, what is the question?
How precisely is the high irreversibility defined?
How precisely is irreversibility defined? I'm not sure about the question. Experimentally, we have a resolution. We are able to resolve the Kolmogorov scale. And our velocity measurements are precise up to the velocity at the Kolmogorov scale.
So is that defined by this quantity DL?
Yes, irreversibility is defined by this quantity DL. So you just
That's an average. That's an average.
Yes, there is some average, so it means that we average over what we average is. You see here, you have a little scheme. We take one point over one trajectory, and we draw a ball of size L, and we look at all trajectories falling into this ball. So we compute the dispersion inside this ball. We compare it with the dispersion forward following the trajectory at time t plus tau or at time t minus tau. And doing the difference allows us to compute the backward or the forward pair dispersion. By just doing the difference between these two quantities, we are able to compute this quantity.
Thanks very much.
Precise up to our measurement.
Thanks very much.
Yeah. Can I ask Sipa? I have some questions about the experiment. If you can please show the experimental setup. Did you have some propeller type thing at the bottom? I mean, is it a rotational flow, or what was the nature of flow there? You had some propeller type of thing at the bottom, I saw.
This one?
Yeah, at the bottom there is a rotating blade, I guess.
Yes, a rotating blade, yes.
And so what is the flow you are studying? You are studying an axisymmetric rotational flow, or what type of flow are you studying actually?
We study a flow in which the two propellers are counter-rotating. So one part of the flow is rotating in one direction, the other part is rotating in the other direction, and in the middle there is a shear layer with a stagnation point at the middle. So this is where we study the flow. This is the place where the turbulence is almost homogeneous and isotropic, but also where velocity are very small, so that particles stay a lot of time in the field of view of cameras. And so we can really have a good statistics over there.
I don't know, it's quite a complex flow. I mean, it may set up several cells actually, depending on... You may not have a strict vortex sheet or something at the middle. It may separate in two regions. It may have multiple cells. And anyway, apart from this, as far as the dissipation is concerned, did you measure any dissipation using microphones, acoustic dissipation due to pressure diffusion terms? Pressure, PV square, PV cube.
No. We measured energy injection using torque, and we measure energy dissipation in the superfluid experiment by using calorimetric measurement. And yeah, we check that both agree within 10%.
Long questions later. Huh? Okay. Short questions now. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, so maybe I can turn to the numerical investigation. So now I remind you, what I do is that I take a fluid and I impose a given forcing to this fluid, and I measure the viscosity that is needed to maintain the energy exactly constant. So the advantage is that it's a very easy measurement, but varying the resolution, because I will do a numerical investigation, will be a kind of nightmare. So what is the framework? The framework, in fact, is the framework of something called reversible Navier-Stokes. It was a framework invented actually by Galavotti in 1996. And the first study of this equation, we performed it with Vishwanath and Shukla in 2019 using a direct numerical simulation. So the equation looks like exactly the same as the Navier-Stokes equation, except that nu now is a control parameter. We adjust it at each time so that the total kinetic energy is constant. So because now nu depends on time, we cannot define the control parameter as the Reynolds number. So now the proper control parameter is this quantity, which we called RR, which is the ratio of the F0, which is the forcing amplitude, times the length of the forcing, the typical length of the forcing, divided by the constant kinetic energy. And you notice an interesting thing is that if there is no anomaly, if d of u is zero, then you can just have a very simple expression for the viscosity. It's just the work of the force divided by the total entropy in the flow. But for weak solution, when d of u is non-zero, there could be a contribution from this term d of u. And so a possibility to be able to sustain a flow with a forcing with a very small viscosity, and as we will see, even a zero viscosity. As I told you, the proper measurement now is nu as a function of the constant energy, so RR, which is given by RR. And this is what we observe. The green and the blue and the red dot are correspond to flow at different resolution. Green is fairly low resolution, 64 cube, while blue and red were at 128 cube. And the square and dot correspond to different way to apply the forcing. So either by maintaining F0 constant and changing E, so to make RR vary, or we keep E constant and vary F0 to change RR. And you see that both way collapse on the same field, so that it's a good control parameter. Okay, so what do we observe here for the viscosity needed to maintain a fluid at a constant energy when it is forced? You see immediately two regimes. A first regime where the viscosity increases like RR to the square, then a very steep increase, and then a sort of saturation at a large value of RR. And if you do some measurement of energy spectrum, for example, you observe a very different quantitative and qualitative behavior. On the left, you see the energy spectrum in this region here, where the RR square is valid. And you see that we have at large scale some steep spectrum, which can be close to K minus 5 third in some situation, and then a K square tail, which is reminiscent of a thermalization at large scale. On the other hand, when we go towards the large RR limit, then we have an energy spectrum which really looks like that of a normal viscous fluid. And in between, where the viscosity increases very sharply, there is a transition. And we have checked that this transition appears because this is a kind of bistable region where the fluid is hesitating between the thermalized solution where mean vorticity is very high, like you see on the red curve, and the normal region where vorticity is milder. And in between, you can have very large oscillation, so that if you look at the variance of the total entropy, it diverges actually at the location where you have the transition. And what is very nice is that you have a mean field critical exponent, both for the variance and for the mean vorticity. So this kind of transition is really like a phase transition. It's very interesting. So it connects anomalous dissipation in some sense to a phase transition. But there is a resolution issue in all these things, because you may say, okay, but why do I have a thermalized region here at small scale? So this, of course, is due to our finite resolution. And this is known for a long time, that if you truncate either Euler equation, no viscosity, which is shown on the top, or Navier-Stokes equation on the bottom, then you have, because you truncate, then you conserve exactly energy, solution have to thermalize. And in the Euler, they do it progressively, starting from the smaller scale. The K square tail increase progressively until it invades the whole spectrum. While in Navier-Stokes, you can sustain a mixed energy spectrum, as we see here, and the location where you have the transition between normal K-5-star spectrum and the K-square tail actually depends on your resolution and on the value of K-max theta. So both these studies were done by a team of Marquetier and Brachet. Here you have the reference. So what we see here, the thermalization, is really a finite resolution effect. And so it will be interesting to see what is happening when I decrease the resolution. And because, of course, if I were able to do the kind of the thing I'm doing here with the real field, I would like to know what is happening to all these different phenomena that I have observed here. So as you know, it's very difficult to do with the DNS. We barely were able to go from 64 to 128. And then using a top supercomputer, we went to 1028 cube. But the jump is not very big. And what we decided to do is to use the technique of log lattice, which was invented by Shiro Campolina and Alexei Mailibayev in 2018. The idea being that if you consider Navier-Stokes equation written in spectral space, normal case, you use a linear Fourier grid, and then reaching very small scale is a pain, or very large wave number is a pain because you have a linear increase of the different wave number. And the idea is that you can, so you need a lot of modes to have very small scale. But of course, if you now you go on a log grid, where now the wave number can be exponentially spaced, then a few modes are needed to go to very, very small scale. So the main difficulty when changing from the Fourier grid to log grid is to deal with the convolution, because as you know, the nonlinear term needs that you need to have interaction between triads of wave vector. So you need to be able to close triangles. So closing triangles on a linear grid is very easy, but on log grid, it's a mess. And in fact, you can do it only for some special values of lambda. And in the sequel, we can use different values, but we use the intermediate one because 1.6019, because it is the one that allows a rather big number of interactions, 6 to the d per node, but at not too much numerical price. Okay, so doing that, we repeated the same game than with DNS. So you see again the viscosity as a function of RR, and you see it at different resolutions. So now n equal 8 is the number of log lattice mode we use per dimension. So n equal 8 may seem very, very small, but it corresponds to a Kmax of 270. And if we go to n to the 20, which is the orange value, then we go to Kmax, which is equal to nearly 80,000, which presently would be impossible to get through DNS. So the first thing we check is that we have the same picture, and you see that if you look at the blue resolution, which is kind of equivalent to our 128 simulation, we obtain the same picture with an increase with an exponent close to 2, then a steep increase, and then a kind of saturation. On the left, on this part, we also have spectrum, but with 2 slope. But now the thermalized slope is not anymore k to the 2, because since we have on a log grid, effective dimension is kind of 0. So that thermalization is rather reduced by k to the minus 1. On the right, we also have a normal viscous spectrum, so everything is the same. And we also check that the phase transition that we had can also be observed. And here you see, for example, on the divergence of the fluctuations, the impact of resolution. For low resolution, there is no really divergence of the fluctuation. But if you increase the resolution, then you start to observe the real divergence of the fluctuation. So it's very important to go to smaller scale to obtain this kind of thing. Okay, so yes.
So this k to the minus one, is it something expected, or is it corresponding to the k square in the
yes k? Yes, because when when it's thermalized, you have equipartition of energy, so uk is constant, and so if you look at the spectrum, it should go like k to the d minus one, and so in 3D this is k square, but for log lattice, as I told you, the effective dimension is zero. So you expect to see k minus one.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so now we can really see the influence of resolution is that, you know, if I increase the resolution, there is some things that doesn't change, is that the right part of the curve, the viscous part, does not change. All the simulation fall off on the same universal curve. As you increase the resolution, this RR square slope, it gradually decrease, while there is a kind of a collapse on the universal curve here that we can fit, and that actually corresponds to the fact that you reach a zero viscosity at a finite value of RR. You see, it's an algebraic decay. So it means that if I continue, and presumably at infinite resolution on this part, there will be a collapse onto a universal part where the corresponding solution here is such that at RR equal 2.5, you can sustain a constant force, but with no viscosity. Okay. What is interesting so is that if I look at this part where you have not yet reached RR equal 2.5, here I show you the energy input as a function of the Reynolds number based on the energy. You see that as I increase the resolution, the energy input tends to flatten a little bit, like what is observed in the real field, but it does not flatten exactly. You know, there is a small trend. It is not exactly constant, and so that on this branch there is no anomalous dissipation. So now let's see what is going on now at the left of this value 2.5. At the left of this value 2.5, I have this thermolike, this two fluid solution, and now here I don't know if you see very well, but you see spectra at different value of RR. You see, and so the orange one are the biggest one, and the blue are the smallest one. And you see that as RR is decreased, the spectrum here tends to become less and less steep, which means that the corresponding H exponent, if you want, the Hölder regularity, I remind you that the energy spectrum is k minus one minus two H, is decreasing as RR is decreasing. And also, if I continue this branch, I'm not sure whether this branch will all collapse onto this branch, or there will remain a little branch here, which I have put it in red, which would correspond to a branch where you have it is sufficient to you don't need any viscosity to sustain the fluid. But you can still apply a forcing. So this would correspond to Euler dissipative weak solution, okay? While the black one, the one that I have shown before, that collapsed to zero in algebraic, correspond to a viscous non-dissipative hydrodynamic branch. So at this stage, I can make a conjecture, and I have no idea whether this conjecture is true or not, is that in our phase space, we could have two kind of solution, a normal viscous branch solution over here, where there is no anomalous dissipation, and which ends at the point here, at 2.5, corresponding to a weak solution of Euler with Hölder exponent h to the minus one third. And on the right branch here, you have a sort of a solution like this that I showed, that you have a power law energy spectrum with an exponent minus one minus two h. And to ensure that there are finite energy, you need to have H, which is greater than zero. And to ensure that they are dissipative, you need to ensure that H is less than one third. And so this red branch here would be a way to connect all this kind of a weak solution of the layer that are dissipative. So it will be the area where they live. Of course, it is possible to show it. It's Simon Talabar who pointed this to me, that if you have an energy spectrum like behave like this, then it's easy to show that R necessarily goes like H times J of H, where J is a function that depends how the weak solution dissipates. And so by monitoring H between zero and one third, then you can actually describe this whole potential red solution. Okay, so there is construction of dissipative Euler weak solution by a convex integration, and this is what Matsumoto is trying to do with Risch. Buckmaster et al. Started to build this kind of thing. And my question is, in our case, in the log lattice, can we observe this weak solution? And here we have a problem, and this is a problem that was pointed out by a lot of people in this audience, first by Ray et al., and more recently Murugan et al., is that the problem is that in numerical simulation, we are only able to do finite resolution, so we have truncated solution. And we know that on the way to thermalization, because of the truncation, then there is apparition of tigers, this weird oscillation, as soon as the resolution becomes of the same order of magnitude that the distance to the real X of the closest complex singularity. And this is bad because, as is illustrated here on the top, these tigers, then they hide the weak solution, the correct weak solution, and we cannot capture it. what they suggest is that to be able to capture the suitable weak solution, that in our case, since we are at finite resolution, we will never capture because of this tiger, they suggest some strategy to purge tigers. As you see, it works very well. So in our case, we didn't try to do very strong strategy. What we did, we start from the case where no forcing, no viscosity, so Euler solution, plain Euler solution. And as we know by the work of Campalina and Melibaev, there is actually a blow up in finite time. If you start from finite initial condition, there is a blow up in finite time where a spectrum in k minus 7/3 develops, and vorticity, here you see the inverse of vorticity, goes to zero in finite time, and in which this singularity is characterized by a chaotic attractor that travels in the wave scale space, and where the energy is concentrated on these strange looking like figures that travel from the left bottom to the right high, developing the singularity. And so we can start from this, but we have finite resolution. So after some time, this attractor will hit the resolution, and then tigers will form, and this will spoil our solution. And what we would like is to be able to continue this solution, which obviously is non-dissipative because it has a very strong, very steep slope, k minus 7/3, corresponding to h equal to 2/3. So we would like to continue this past the singularity time. Because the idea is that if now I go past the blow-up, then there are no more unique solutions anymore, and we could be able to find a lot of weak solution, dissipative solution. So to purge tigers, what we did, we didn't do a very big strategy. We used hyperviscosity. This strategy was, by the way, advertised recently by Fenn et al. In a recent GFM, where they use this strategy on Euler using discontinuous Galerkin function to try to capture the suitable weak solution, a suitable weak solution of Euler past the blow up. And they saw a tendency to see K minus 5 thirds. And it's a very large simulation. You see K max is of the order of 10 to the 4. And they use hyperviscosity so that after some time where the vorticity increases, it gets saturated. And then you see developing of the K minus 5 thirds. So we did the same with log lattice. We started the simulation from initial condition and put a viscous wall at the end using viscosity first. And you see that indeed, like in the DNF, after K minus 7 third, a time where the spectrum develops the K minus 7 third law, the same than for Euler, the attractor hits the viscous wall, and then you have a kind of reflection, and you try to turn to a spectrum that is less steep than K minus 7 thirds, but not quite K minus 5 thirds. So we try different hyperviscosity. We vary the type of dissipation. Instead of using the viscous dissipation nu K to the K to the 2 U, we use gamma as a parameter to see what was the slope that we could achieve. And here in blue, you see the slope, the H exponent achieved by using different value of gamma. And you see that when we get a very steep hyperviscosity, so presumably a very good way to remove the tigers, then we indeed asymptote the K minus 5 third slope. So by this procedure, we get asymptotic approach to H equal 1 third. So this is the weak Euler solution corresponding to H equal 1 third, so this solution. But up to now, we were not able to obtain any kind of solution lying in between, if they indeed exist. It's not sure that they exist. So this is a work in progress. We are trying different strategies. And this leads me to the end of my talk. Using log lattice, then we have identified in the reversible Navier-Stokes a transition as a function of the kinetic energy, so the temperature, where the fluid changes from a non-anomalous viscous regular hydrodynamic flow to a mixture of two fluids, thermalized and anomalous flow. In the infinite resolution limit, we have a conjecture, but maybe it's completely wrong, that the mixture could tend to dissipative weak solution of the Euler equation of finite energy. And so the question is that, can we get the possible weak dissipative solution of LL, of log lattice RNS? Obviously, we starting from Euler is not sufficient. We just get the convergence to H equal 1 third. We don't get any other solution. But maybe there is a strategy that is possible. And if you have ideas, I will be happy to hear them. Second question is, are all the things I have been discussing also true for DNS reversible Navier-Stokes? But it's very difficult to check this because of the it's much more expensive to go to high resolution. And as a perspective also, this is the thing I have been discussing a lot with Vishwanath, and he's not much convinced, but maybe he will be more convinced, is that is this reversible Navier-Stokes a good model of superfluid? And the idea is that when we cross this limit, when we go from the thermalized or the weak solution regime to the viscous regime, you see the spectral growth from the red one to the black one. And this is exactly the kind of thing that we see in our experiment when we go from the green one, which would correspond to the red one here, to the orange one, which is correspond to the black one here. So it's a question I am thinking, and if you have comments about this, I will be happy to take them. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the talk. Questions, Dhruba.
Hi, Binarjit, this is Dhruba. I have two urgent questions and others if only the chairperson allows me. One thing is that you talk about DL and the epsilon, and you said that Rivas's result shows that there is a relation between them.
I'm sorry, I don't hear you.
Can you hear me now? Hello?
Yes, hello, I hear you. Yes.
Okay, great. Great. So thanks for a great talk. It was a tour de force, which covered possibly every aspect of modern turbulence research. I'm going to ask few questions and more if the chairperson allows me, but please understand they are coming mostly from my ignorance. First thing I want to ask is that you said that the DL and the epsilon, there is a relation between them, which Drivas proved. Now, it's that relation about their mean, or does it also cover their fluctuations? Because epsilon has very large fluctuations, right?
Yes. It's also about their fluctuation.
So they should have the same probability distribution.
Yes.
Okay. The second one is...
But the total, the viscous plus the DL contribution, no?
You didn't get that.
There can be two contributions. There is one that comes from viscosity, and there is one that comes from these irregularities, this weak solution, weak dissipative solution.
Okay, I think that's a longer question for me. The other thing is that the integration that you are using for the thermalized, for the constant energy ensemble of the Navier-Stokes, does it? So this kind of things, if I remember properly, was first done by Rondoni and those people. And then I think Buffetta also did some of the calculations.
Yes.
In a shell model, what they used to do is that they used a Runge-Kutta scheme, and the system lost energy, and they rescaled every variable back to get the energy back. Are you using the same scheme, or are you using some symplectic scheme which really conserves energy?
No. We did the same thing. We use RNS. I mean, the idea was that viscosity just control. So we use exactly the same scheme.
So you rescale back to a higher to this constant value at a certain time interval.
Yeah. We so it allows us to get what viscosity do we need to maintain the energy, which is exactly. What is our field? But we do the same trick using we use Runge-Kutta and viscous splitting.
Thanks very much. Rest are less urgent and only.
So we'll take questions from the audience here first. Please go ahead.
I have a very quick question. In the superfluid case, you said that the dissipation was only because of this irregularity of the field. But when we use something like the HVBK model, we also include a small viscosity in the superfluid component. And the words that go with it are that it models small scale vortex reconnection and so on. So are you sure that there is none of that effect in your experiments?
First, superfluid is only superfluid at zero temperature limit. Okay. So in finite temperature limit, there is still the possibility that there remains a small part of the viscous fluid. And second, your model HBKV is a model of superfluid, right? But maybe we could switch to another paradigm where we say that superfluid is a dissipative weak solution of Euler. It's another model. That was my question in the end. So in that view, I don't need all these HBKV things anymore. I just use RNS and I say, superfluid is a weak solution dissipative of the Euler equation.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, we'll take from someone different first.
Thanks a lot for the talk. The reversible Navier-Stokes, it's a bit new for me. I was curious what happens to vortex reconnections in this kind of flow. Are these vortex topologies preserved, or can they reconnect and change and simplify?
Okay, so I'm not sure I hear very well. You are asking about vortex reconnection in the log lattice?
No, in the RNS, reversible Navier-Stokes.
In the reversible Navier-Stokes. So I don't know. We did not study this very in detail. I know that Giorgio Krustulovich tried to do a little bit, a little movie of seeing how what is happening. But what is happening is that you see something, some kind of singular behavior, and then you have tigers developing, and then thermal noise everywhere, and you don't see anything. So I cannot really answer your question. In DNS, it's very difficult. And in log lattice, this is the problem with log lattice, is that it's difficult to come back to the real space, because obviously you cannot do. I mean your fluid is very sparse. You don't have all the Fourier modes, so it's difficult to define what is a vortex, etc. We are working toward this problem, but right now it's not solved. We don't know really what is happening in physical space using log lattice. So I'm sorry, it's a very interesting question, and we would like to answer this, but for the moment we don't have enough resolution by DNS, and we don't have the mean to go into physical space by log lattice. But what I want to point out that in log lattice, the Euler blow-up proceeds with a K-7 third law. So this is a law which corresponds to conservation of helicity. And this kind of law is observed in superfluid when you prevent reconnection of vortices, because so that you can conserve exactly the helicity. And so maybe this has some link with your question, but I'm not sure it answers totally.
Thanks a lot for the answer. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Just a sec.
Hi, Behangère. Here's Siru.
Hi.
Thanks for the talk. I have just a question. I think in one of your slides, you were comparing the log lattices with, I think, DNS, yes, showing the transition from -7/3 to -5/3, yes, on log lattices. Do you observe, yes, the development of a -7/3 for DNS as well?
Yes, in fact, for DNS, we observe it in some situation in the intermediate region, you know, where there are very wide fluctuation of entropy, because the solution is bistable, the spectrum varies a lot with time. And if you look at the energy spectrum after the thermalization, I mean, there is a thermalization regime and then some power law, then you see that the spectrum are the spectra are limited by -3 and -7/3, actually. So you never exactly observe the -7/3 as a fixed point, like in log lattice, but you observe hint that indeed this -7/3 is relevant.
Okay, thank you very much. And thanks for the talk.
Yeah.
One more question there, and then we'll come to you. Yes, Rajesh, go ahead if you have a mic.
Hello. Yeah, I had a couple of questions. One is, you mentioned that the effective dimension of a log lattice is zero. Is it for a 3D log lattice grid, 2D log lattice grid, or is it a special case?
Yeah, it's for a 3D lattice, because see, because the wave number are exponentially spaced, the element of volume in between two shells is not k square, but it's more like a constant in some sense. So so this is true for any dimension. In any dimension, log lattice, because they are exponentially spaced, they are effectively zero dimensional. I mean, as far as thermalization is concerned. I mean, this is something we have been discussing a lot with Ciro Campolin and Alexei. This is what we think now. Maybe we will come with with another conclusion later, but for the present time, this is what we think.
I see. And the next question is, can you talk about how you measure Kolmogorov length scale in experiments where you are changing the forcing?
Can you repeat louder, sorry, please? We don't hear you very much.
I was asking, can you tell us about how you are measuring the Kolmogorov length scale in an experiment when you're changing the forcing?
Okay. So Kolmogorov length scale is just defined by nu 3 over epsilon to the one force, right? In our experiment, we know the fluid. So we know it's the value of its viscosity. And epsilon, we know it by performing torque measurement applied as a different propeller. So by measuring torque measurement, we have an idea of energy injection. And because our flow is stationary and well thermalized, we thermalize all our experiments, we know that all the energy that is in goes out. So we have epsilon dissipated, which is equal to energy injected. And so we can measure Kolmogorov length.
I see. Thank you.
Vinoshree, just one comment. The 1 over k factor is very well known in shell models.
1 over what is very well known in shell model? The one?
The 1 over k factor for the log lattice.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. For the same reasons than in log lattice. Yes.
Okay. There's one question on the chat box, which was asked long ago, so we should take it. It's from Claude Bardos about comparison with smooth solution. If he's there, he can unmute himself and ask also if he wanted to expand on it.
Okay, just I want to shortly to comment with the the relation with the basic fact for when you have smooth solution. So if you look at the limit of Navier-Stokes starting from smooth initial data and assume that the earlier equation for a finite time has a smooth solution, then the limit of Navier-Stokes of Leray solution of Navier-Stokes, not all, but with the Leray hypothesis, they are the smooth solution. So that means that what you do is not in such situation. So not in such situation, that will mean that I look at the shells, what are the situation for wild solution. As far as I know, now there are two types. There are the family of solution of Delelis and Secchedilli. And for this family, they require that the initial data should be singular. Otherwise, it will be not in agreement with what you said. And the other type of result, which I know, are the result of Eldingi. Eldingi, he assumes that the initial data is in some C0 alpha, but with alpha maybe slightly small, nothing to much smaller than the Onsager. And then he showed that there exists solution of Euler with a vorticity that blows up in a finite time. Maybe it's in a cylinder, but at least it's an example. And then there are also results of Tom O, which I don't understand so well, that I don't want up to now to commit. But really what you do is in between these different situations. And that raises two questions at least. First, did you check that the limit is a weak solution of Euler? And second, when if it is weak solution of Euler, at some point, the singularity may appear. It may be already in by your construction, which accommodates smooth initial data. But so at what time does it become singular in the numerical computation? Immediately after the time zero or later on? Well, that's more or less the comment.
Yeah. So in the log lattice simulation, when we start by are they smooth initial condition? I don't know. We start from power law initial condition, so I'm not sure they're smooth, by the way. We observe blow up in finite time, and finite time is order one. I mean, zero point something. It depends on initial condition, actually. Okay.
No, but I wonder what are the accommodated initial conditions that accommodate what you do?
No, they are not singular because we start from a power loop, but that extends which has finite extent, so it's kind of regular because it doesn't go to k equal infinity, and we let it develop, but then we observe a blow up in finite time. But what you said is very interesting because it means that it may explain why we. With our strategy, we only fall on the h equal 1/3, which is a Onsager solution. Maybe it's because we didn't put the correct initial condition. Maybe we should start from more regular.
It's more interesting to follow what you do just to see where appears the discrepancy between having a smooth solution of Euler and.
Yeah. But in our case, even with log lattice, we always have finite resolution, so they are all regulars.
Yeah.
You see? So okay. I cannot tell you that, so that's why I made a conjecture about the infinite limit, is how the limit will be going. But that's very interesting. That's a good point. Okay. Thank you, Claude.
Okay, then thanks for the talk. It's super anyway.
Okay. One more question in the back. Yeah. I found the work to be really nice. I just have a small question on the experiment aspect.
Can you talk louder, please? I don't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I said I have a small question regarding the experiment part. So in your measurements of the dissipation, so the whole flow is anyway contained with there are solid boundaries. So there would be some contribution to the dissipation coming from the presence of these boundaries. So my question is, is the contribution significant in any way, or do you correct for it, or is there a deviation?
Well, this is a good question, and unfortunately, I cannot answer to you because, as I told you, in the experiment, all we have access to is the energy input, is the forcing, the work of the force, okay? That's not true. So in the water experiment, all we have access is the work of the force. And so we measure the injected energy. And then by the first law, we say that if we are in a stationary situation, all that is being injected has been dissipated. So we have a measurement of the global energy dissipation, and we don't know where are the different contributions. And in the superfluid experiment, it is very carefully thermalized. And so we are able to measure directly the heat dissipated within the experiment. So contribution of viscosity and from everywhere. And we are able to observe that within 10 persons, there is an agreement between injection and dissipation and the heat dissipated, if you want. But all these measurements are global. And right now, there is no way we can do a local measurement of energy dissipation, except by the D of L that I explained. But to be able to resolve the boundaries, we will need another apparatus because it's boundaries right now are too narrow to be resolved by our velocity measurement system.
Thank you. I have one short question. Did you actually observe reconnections in the experiment? I thought
we were able to observe them.
And your D was something, there was a pattern with respect to D wherever you had reconnections.
Yes, what we using D, we were able to look for interesting points, and on this we study in a very detailed way the behavior of the different components of vorticity of the flow at this location. And right at the time where the D was very big, we observed that the order of the different component change in time, and this is the signature of a reconnection.
I see. Okay.
So right now what we are doing is we are trying to do statistics about this reconnection event now that we know how to identify them. And we would like to do statistics to study, for example, time of approach or time of departure and things like this.
Okay.
Experimentally, this is a challenge, but now we have all the tools to do it.
Great, thank you. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, I think experiment is as big a challenge as theory also, or analysis. And my question is, of course, question/comment. See, depending on the rotational speed you used and the fluid used, you are creating mechanical structural modes, which actually create acoustic modes in the dissipation scale limit. And I don't know whether you considered that, because you haven't used microphones or anything to perhaps capture those potential, turbulent pressure dissipation modes due to acoustic energy. That is the PV correlations, higher order and PV, PV squared, those correlations. And the other thing is the other question previously asked about the boundary effect. Of course, the boundary effect should go as viscous molecular dissipation, viscous dissipation. And the problem with these, when you go to the molecular and dissipation limit, you have to one has to use an adiabatic wall. A strictly adiabatic wall, and doing those experiments are not easy. So that's my view and comments. I mean, question and comments. If you have any views about that I would be happy to listen. Anyway, it's a very interesting talk. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, to reply, we did not measure the sound effect with microphone because there is a problem anyway of a contribution of bubbles and things like this. So to avoid this, we pressurize our experiment to avoid cavitation. But anyway, it's a big mess. And but boundary effect, we don't have resolution to study it right now. So
okay, we are towards the end of the session, unless there are any more quick questions for Professor De Bruyl. If not, let's thank her again for the great talk.